Hey, it's Jordan. Delighted to be joined by Krystal Ball of Rising fame. Definitely check out Rising. I think you're almost at a million subscribers. I'm jealous.
Getting there. It's been very exciting what we've seen happen there this year.
Yeah, definitely. So I wanted to start, we could get to Trump later, but I guess it's improvement. We're not hearing Russia responsible for Democrats' loss this time, at least yet. We're hearing socialism, defund the police, and a bunch of fact-free nonsense. I wanted to get your thought, because it's kind of like just there's data, there's facts. I mean, it's not hard to find that none of these candidates that lost were running on defund the police or Medicare for All or anything like that. What do you think of the latest spin, and how do progressives combat that?
Yeah, well, I mean, like you said, there are facts and data, not that they care. They want to assert this like vague sense that, you know, Medicare for All and defund the police were some big issue. When you actually look at the data, number one, progressive ballot initiatives were extraordinarily popular, whether it was decriminalizing all drugs in the state of Oregon, legalizing marijuana, or $15 minimum wage in Florida, which passed with 60% of the vote. What's more, every single candidate in a swing district who backed Medicare for All won, whereas who got tossed out? A bunch of do-nothing blue dog corporatists. So that's the reality, not to mention the fact that look, Democrats got the nominee that they wanted in Joe Biden. Like, the Democratic establishment got their centrist corporatist candidate in Joe Biden. They've got Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi in leadership, and Sherry Bustos, another corporatist, running the DCCC. So they were in control of the party and the messaging. Seems logical to me that any failures thereof stem directly from the leadership and their lack of ability to run really on anything other than we're not Trump. So to me, look, if Bernie had been the nominee or even Elizabeth Warren had been the nominee and there were failures down ballot, you know 100% they would blame the top of the ticket, but it doesn't serve their narrative. So surprise, surprise, they're finding another way to punch left, which is what they always, always, always do, even though they have all the leadership structure and the candidate that they said the Democrats had to nominate in order to perform, and ultimately they still don't perform.
Right. I'd like your thoughts, because on one end you got Biden, you know, every other Tuesday you see a piece that he's going to be like FDR, but then but then you get, you know, the lowering of expectations. He doesn't really talk about the public option like he did during the campaign. Yeah. You're hearing, you heard from his, I guess, top advisor, oh, you know, we're really behind the eight ball with debt. We don't know if we're going to be able to do much. And you're already seeing them basically throwing up their hands like, well, McConnell, you know, he might have the Senate, so they'll block everything. So it just seems to me like this narrative that, you know, I'm going to be like FDR, and there's nothing America can't do, is actually being hijacked by the Uber, Facebook, and other Wall Street types he's already thinking about putting in his administration.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to govern the way that he's governed for 47 years, right? We should not expect any big surprises. It doesn't happen ever that a politician gets elected and then does lots of good stuff that they didn't promise you on the campaign trail. It happens all the time that they promise things that sound good and then they don't deliver, but they never get in an office and then are like, oh my God, surprise, by the way, we're going to give you guys healthcare. Like, that doesn't happen. We didn't even get a specific commitment to what a stimulus package would look like from Joe Biden. He certainly didn't run on that. So yeah, I observed the same thing you observed. The minute that it looked like Democrats weren't going to get control of the Senate, as one example, Ruth Marcus over the Washington Post, she wrote, oh, Joe Biden's got mission impossible now. He can't get anything done because the Senate will be intransigent. And certainly, you know, the Senate will be intransigent. Any idea that Joe Biden is going to be able to work together with Mitch McConnell on anything that would be positive, he could work with him on maybe some, you know, bad trade deals or something like that, I think is a complete fantasy. But in the same respect, we shouldn't let them off the hook. There's nothing that Democrats love more than an excuse for their impotence. So think about this. You've got Trump, who they consider and is in certain ways a unique threat, and they can certainly wrap their mind around how he, through the office of the presidency, can make dramatic changes to the country. Well, Joe Biden is about to have that same power. And if he wants to use it, through regulatory enforcement, through executive orders, he too can make large and dramatic changes. Couple of obvious examples are rescheduling marijuana. Another one is eliminating, he could, with an executive order, very firm ground to eliminate the student debt burden. This is something that Elizabeth Warren and actually Chuck Schumer, who's clearly terrified of a primary challenge, are pushing him to do. So there's still a lot that he could do, which may not be the fundamental transformation that you and I would like to see, but nonetheless would be significant and make a difference. We should not give him a pass and lower expectations from day one that, Republicans, mean Republicans, are going to block any good thing. So all we can hope for is, like, you know, rolling back the clock to 2012 and getting rid of some of the Trump era executive orders.
But Rahm Emanuel told me we're going to put a down ballot on a down payment on progressive values. So it must be that simple.
What does that even mean? To Rahm Emanuel, I'm frightened to know what that means from Rahm Emanuel.
And something you guys do really well, you and Sagar, is talk about kind of the long-term trends. I mean, you're not really hearing this, but Biden shrunk from Hillary's margins among black women, black men, Latino women. Honestly, Trump went from 8% to 12% among black people. 4% doesn't sound like a lot, but for Donald Trump and the Republicans, I would say it is. I think Trump and that, you know, he got a record number of votes for Republicans. Is that more sustainable, that increased Republican turnout, or that increased Democratic turnout when you're not going to have Trump to run against? Because it seems like the Democratic Party, you, Chuck Rocha, have talked about it extensively, really, really didn't really bother that much with extensive Latino outreach, and black outreach seemed kind of late as well.
Yeah, no, they got exactly the coalition that they wanted. They got exactly the voters to turn out and get excited who they targeted. The restore the soul of the nation, this sort of like vague, you know, decency is on the ballot type of rhetoric was targeted at a very specific group of suburban, mostly white, affluent voters. And that, in fact, is where we saw the largest increases for Joe Biden. Here in Virginia, Stafford County, which is one I'm really familiar with, had this massive, it's an exurban town here where people are commuting into D.C. Not super rich, but relatively doing well, relatively prosperous, white collar, massive shift towards Biden. Same thing with Loudoun County. Those are the voters that they really sought to appeal to, and they were very successful in that. I will say, you know, there's a lot of kind of triumphalism, weirdly, among Republicans, even though they lost, because they see these modest gains among black voters and more significant gains among Latino voters. I was just digging into some of the data on Latino voters in particular, and where they actually made gains was overwhelmingly with the wealthiest Latino voters. So Joe Biden and the Democrats still overwhelmingly won voters under 50K, voters between 50 and 100K. Donald Trump actually won Latino voters over 100K. So there's more of a class story to tell within that Latino vote than has been dug into yet nationally, which makes sense. We're still getting results in and like still digging into all of this. I'd be interested to see those numbers among African-American voters too. The other piece that I'm really curious about is generational. I mean, as you and I know from covering the Sanders campaign, massive generational divide in their sort of partisan loyalty. Like there's just not as much of we're just going to be partisan cheerleaders for the Democrats no matter what they do, or partisan cheerleaders for the Republicans no matter what they do. And so some of the early indicators I saw in the African-American vote was that it was actually younger African-Americans more than older African-Americans who shifted towards Donald Trump. So I think that's a really interesting phenomenon to dig into as well. But overall, look, I didn't think either of these candidates really deserved a win. I prefer Joe Biden. I think he'll be better than Donald Trump, and I'm relieved that Donald Trump lost. But this result to me is as close to voters rejecting everybody as you could get. There were losses and disappointments all the way around, and I sort of think that's appropriate, given that you had two guys who essentially ran on nothing in terms of an affirmative, positive economic agenda for the American people. To me, that lane is still wide open if anyone wants to take it. Unfortunately, what I think is more likely is that these two parties continue to largely represent their respective elite interests, and that the working class largely remains divided among racial lines.
Right. And in terms of the progressive movement, I mean, listen, I'm a little cynical. I don't see us moving Joe Biden left. I think we're lucky if we prevent him from going, you know, full-born John Kasich. With that said, you know, Obama, progressives largely went to sleep, but you didn't have the Sunrise Movement then. You didn't have this infrastructure that in large part came from the Bernie movement. What do you think in terms of the progressive movement? Are we going to see more, you know, AOC calling Pelosi Mama Bear and a lot of the progressive caucus kind of not that confrontational with the Democratic leadership? Maybe it's because they didn't have the numbers. Now they have more numbers. What do you see playing out? What would you like to see play out in terms of now you have Cori Bush, Jamal Bowman, and obviously the remaining progressives in the Senate and House?
I share your cynicism and your skepticism. You know, Joe Biden, from his perspective, won the primary telling progressives to piss off, won the general election with young voters surging in turnout and providing him with a larger margin than Hillary Clinton won, who, you know, young voters being overwhelmingly progressive. So he brought people over without having to give in one inch to the progressive side of the party. I think that's his view, and he'll govern consistent with how he's governed over the past 47 years. What I will say on a more optimistic note is you are 100% right that there is a lot more infrastructure. There's a lot more space. Independent outlets like your own help provide some of that voice that was much more limited back during the Obama administration. And so the fact that days after Joe Biden wins the election, you have people like AOC already coming out and saying, here's our demands, here's what's unacceptable, here's how your narrative about centrism being ascendant is bullshit. The fact that you have that out of the gates is dramatically different from the Obama administration. We should recognize that as progress in and of itself. I think the only place where there's real power to be potentially wielded is in both primaries in 2022 and primary against either Joe or Kamala in 2024. That's the next time when you really have leverage. And I think that's the most important tool for progressives and democratic socialists to ultimately wield at this point, where, you know, our threat of like, oh, this is what we want, not accompanied with any sort of power or impetus behind it, it's gonna fall on deaf ears. But the way that you hold people accountable, because ultimately all they care about is being able to maintain their seat, maintain power, is them feeling threatened in by a potential Democratic primary result. And with respect to 2024, I don't even think you need, because they're so uptight and get so freaked out by any challenge to the sort of neoliberal power establishment, I don't think you even need a primary challenge that they're convinced could be successful. I think the mere threat of like, oh my God, we can't have a messy primary because they just want like no dissent, like a bunch of authoritarians. Even that threat, I think, would create a lot of ultimate angst for them. Last thought on this, on the more pessimistic side, I think it's entirely likely that Donald Trump does run again in 2024. And I think it's almost certain that he threatens to run again in 2024. So it was a very effective method that Democrats used this time, being like, you got to stay in line because Trump is terrible and can't have any dissent, can't have any of these, like, you know, criticizing of the Democratic Party elite because Donald Trump and because the Republicans are so bad. I think it's highly likely that you still have that very effective threat hanging out there quashing dissent. So that's my sort of concern for what the landscape is going to look like moving forward.
It's a good segue to my last question. You and I both, I mean, you were much higher than I, used to work at MSNBC, so you talk about corporate media a lot. I don't know. All these MSNBC, you know, rehabilitated warmongers, they're aghast at what Trump is doing, but I kind of feel low-key, the MSNBCs of the world, the Democratic consulting class, they kind of want Trump to hang around because, well, how are they going to get ratings if Donald Trump is not in the picture? I mean, the people will go back to brunch, so to speak. Do you feel like these same people that are aghast that Trump won't, you know, diplomatically step aside might not, you know, might like the threat of Donald Trump running again, of him having, you know, whatever comes next, Trump TV, because it keeps the anger and fear machine out there?
100%. And so if you are under the illusion that, you know, look, I think Donald Trump is a mess right now. He's ridiculous. All of these allegations are outrageous. The fact that he's not conceding is unconscionable. And I mean, unexpected, like completely expected, right? We all knew that this was the path he was going to go down. But the idea that once he leaves, and he will leave, that he's going to just go away is pure fantasy. And I think one of the reasons is exactly what you're laying out. If he's over there tweeting and doing his own media brand and channel or whatever, which is what I expect him to do and what there's been some reporting indicating he wants to do, of course the cable news networks are still going to cover that like crazy, day in and day out. Because they ultimately are driven by profit motives and a bottom line, and Donald Trump has been very, very good for their ratings. Very, very good for, you know, a bunch of multimillionaire resistance liberal grifters who are going to keep that that train moving as well. So, yeah, Donald Trump may be out of the White House, but and this is fair in a lot of ways. He will still be the leader of the Republican Party because they all still are going to slavishly, embarrassingly like fawn over him and listen to him. And the media is going to give him all the airtime and all the like frenetic panic attacks that he possibly could want.
And we should point out, I mean, Lindsey Graham, a lot of these Republicans now saying, you know, count the votes. He has the legal means. We're really, really 20 years ago. Stop counting in Florida. Stop all the counting. I mean, it's just the hypocrisy has no end. But thank you, Krystal, rising on the Hill on YouTube. You guys do great work, and I appreciate you taking the time.
Thanks, Jordan. Same to you.
Okay.
Hope you enjoyed that last video. Hop on over to statuscoup.com where you can sign up for our email list and become a member for as low as $5 to $10 a month. Membership is how we grow. That's statuscoup.com/join. And remember, join our email list so we can grow the revolution with you.